Hey everyone, welcome back to Hidden Apologetics. Super pumped you are joining us today. We have a really fun and exciting episode right here. I got Tim from Invoking Theism, and we're going to be responding to Stephen Law and his debate with Wayland Craig on Does God Exist, looking at his opening statement and his case against God. So Tim, what's up, man? How you doing?
Oh, dude, I'm doing really good. Thanks for having me on, man.
Yeah, anything you want to say, Tim, with regards to this debate or anything before we get right into Stephen Law's opening statement where he's going to build a case against God's existence?
Yeah, so the first thing I want to say is I think that Stephen Law did a really good job of articulating his points and his responses. And I think that if anybody really wants to kind of see how an evidential argument from evil works, I think that this is a really good kind of intro for them, or for them to really kind of see, because the way he presents it is very concise and it's very precise, and he goes through bit by bit, and I think that he does a good job at that. I also think that that as far as atheological arguments go, that he also does a really good job at representing them, the kind of style of the argument and how the form that it takes in this. And I also think that he'll be talking about his whole evil God hypothesis objection here. And I think that that's also a valuable thing to think about and think through, because the way in which he frames it, and we'll get, when we get to it, we can talk about it more, but the way in which he frames it, it can help theists better reflect on how they respond to evil. I think that's what it really shows. And so if anything, Stephen Law is doing something valuable in trying to bring these to the surface. So,
yeah, I think that's great, Tim, and well said. And we both have a lot of love and respect for Dr. Law. He has some really great work, and hopefully, this video, as always, is seen as like a friendly, loving critique in search of truth, not where we're trying to like go like debunk this guy or anything like that, because that is not either of our intentions. So, yeah. So, if we're ready, let's just dive right into it and get this thing started.
Cool.
It is at 1.25 times speed. So, just FYI on that.
Okay. My thanks to the organizers of this debate for the invitation to take part. I'm genuinely honored to be sharing the stage with Professor Craig this evening. We're here to debate the question, does God exist? And we've just heard some arguments that are supposed to justify an affirmative answer. I'll address those arguments in the first rebuttal period. What I'm going to do in my opening speech is to sketch out an argument against the existence of God. There are many such arguments. I'm going to make things relatively easy for Professor Craig by sketching out just one. It's an argument with which I'm sure you're familiar. It's often called the evidential problem of evil. There's a great deal of bad stuff in the world. There are moral evils, the terrible moral deeds we do. There are also natural evils, such as natural diseases and disasters that cause humans and other creatures immense suffering. Let's start with animal suffering. I recently watched a documentary about Komodo dragons. They track for a week or so after poisoning their prey, and then finally, when their victim becomes too weak to defend itself, they disemboweled and ate it alive, this water buffalo, this poor water buffalo. The cameraman said that this had been his first ever wildlife assignment, and it would probably also have to be his last, because he just couldn't cope with the depths of suffering he had been forced to witness. Each day, millions of animals are similarly forced to tear each other limb from limb in order to survive. And this has been going on for hundreds of millions of years. This might in many ways be a beautiful world, but it's also a quite staggeringly cruel and horrific world for very many of its inhabitants. Some may dismiss all this animal suffering by saying that they're just animals. They don't ultimately matter. But I wonder if they'd say the same thing if I took a red hot poker to their pet cat.
Okay, so the first part I wanted to break off here, Tim, is like his initial thoughts on animal suffering. So do you have anything you want to add right here?
Yeah. So yeah. So I think he was just right about to go into the human suffering side. So So what he lays out basically is he lays out the datum that the theist and the atheist are to deal with. Right. So it's like, okay, what is the datum that we're dealing with? Well, for a multi-million, some could even say billion years process, there has been this long history of a profusion of intense suffering within the animal kingdom and the biosphere, such suffering that has can be considered horrendous, right? And we should be, I don't think we should be neo-Cartesians in denying the consciousness and the quality of states of animals. So I will say that animals with at least higher order animals obviously can actually experience and are aware that they're experiencing pain and things of that sort. And so if that's true and there's many animals, then we can say that there has been a lot of suffering in Animal Kingdom. And the suffering of which is that when we as humans look upon the suffering, it causes us to have not only an emotional response, but also sometimes a physical response, right? And so John Schneider notes in his work on the Darwinian problem of evil, he notes that some people, when they watch, you know, a lion or a tiger, you know, chase down a gazelle or something, or like a water buffalo, it causes us, at the horror of it, to quench on the inside. And, you know, it gets rid of our appetites and things, and, you know, and things of that sort are, you know, it causes us, there's obviously something about it in which we know we have a visceral reaction to. And so basically what he's saying is all these things seem to be greatly, greatly, greatly in tension with the idea that there is a all benevolent God who's also all powerful and all knowing. So he knows that this evil is happening, and he has the power to do something about the evil because it's omnipotent. And obviously God would care about the well-being of creatures, since that seems to be something that we can derive from just goodness itself, right? And so that's the kind of tension that he's setting up here. But I think that an issue with what he's doing is, I don't really see much of an argument here, because the question on theism and the question on atheism is that if this is going to be an evidential chip, you could say, for atheism, then it has to disconfirm, this data has to disconfirm theism. So there has to be something about the evil in which we observe that has to not be expected on theism. Theism should lead us to a false expectation, basically. And they think that it has, right? And so if it disconfirms theism, then it's a point for atheism, you could say, an evidential point for atheism. But the issue here is that he doesn't specify what that is. And what I mean by that is, in the literature, there's this idea of unjustifiable and justifiable evil. And the idea is, because most atheologians aren't going to be making arguments from evil on the logical side of things. And I know that philosophers who I greatly, greatly, greatly respect, such as Trent Doherty, think that the distinction between logical and evidential is a bad one. I'm going to use logical just for a heuristic here. And they're not going to go with the logical. They're going to say that theism can be compatible with evil. They're not going to make that incompatibility argument. And so if theism is compatible with evil, then what kind of evil is theism compatible with? And they're going to say, well, it's of the justifiable kind. And so the question is, well, then if we observe justifiable evil, then theism does not lead us, then theism leads us to a true prediction. It leads us to expect the day. But if we observe evils of the kind that we think are unjustifiable, then theism does not lead us to expect the data and disconfirms theism. That's what Law's trying to do here, but he doesn't specify why these evils are unjustifiable on theism. Why is this suffering unjustifiable on theism? He explains, you know, the profusion and intensity of the suffering that we observe, but then that's not enough. The next logical step is not, and therefore it's unjustifiable given theism. So that's one part that Law doesn't justify. He just kind of states what he thinks the problem is, and then, you know, kind of just says, well, that's evident, you know, implicitly that's an evidential chip against theism. And so he doesn't meet the unjustifiable condition there. And so the next question that we should be asking then is the intense suffering of animals in the biosphere redeemable? And can we say that God has benevolent restoration for animal victims of suffering that will render their lives good on the whole? And so really what this is the main question we should be asking is the suffering redeemable? And what I mean by that is in any theistic explanation, especially when it comes to evil, there is this idea that we should be you know, looking into a theistic eschatology. This is this idea from John Hick, that no theodicy without eschatology. And the idea is that on theism, God is doing something with the state that the universe is in, the state in which creation is in. And so a lot of these arguments from atheists for atheism, such as the evidential arguments, assume that the way in which we observe the world is just the way the world is always going to be, that God isn't going to do something with the evil. And so then the question is, well, if God's going to do something with the evil, it seems to be of character that God will redeem the evil, that God will bring creation eventually to a point where all suffering will be redeemed, that all creatures will be able to look back on their lives and one, be able to be aware that God does love them and that they played a crucial role in creation. And then two, that they consider their lives on the whole worth living, and they actually endorse the things that happen to them. And so they consider their lives and their identities on the whole good. So the question is, well then, if God is able to do that, then I think that that is the correct condition for justifiability we should be looking at. Is the suffering redeemable? And if the suffering is redeemable, then if the suffering we have observed is that, then I think theism doesn't lead us to a false prediction. I think it leads us to expect the data. So I think the main question we should be asking is God going to redeem the suffering, and can it be redeemed? If it can, then I don't think there really is a problem here for animal suffering. So I'll hand it over to you. What do you make of this?
Yeah, I like the point you're bringing up, Tim, and it's something like when I was talking with, you know, your friend Kyle from Christian Idealism, he has like his defeat condition at the problem of evil, where he talks about like given theism, like there's really good reason to expect that even like all evil will be redeemed. All suffering can be redeemed given God. And you have to, when we're thinking about animal suffering, if you're going to argue against theism, you have to consider like the eschatology of theism that can play into it. So I think that's a really good point, Tim, that could be helpful as we keep going. One thing I'd like to add is just thinking about maybe it's something that doesn't just like prove like problem of evil. I know it doesn't prove the problem of evil goes away forever and ever. But like something like here and now that we can see is like, even though there's like immense suffering, I think there's also like immense like aesthetic beauty in the world, even with the way the wildlife is. Like this is a popular example, but like think about the rainforest. Like there's so much suffering in the rainforest, or even in, I believe it's Indonesia where Komodo dragons are. I guess that would be rainforest as well. There's so much suffering that's happening daily, but if you were going to say, hey, we should just destroy the rainforest, people would look at you and be like, what are you talking about? That seems a little crazy. Because even though there is all this suffering that, you know, we can explain as theists and we can talk about the eschaton and things like that, there's also immense beauty just in its existence right now. So that's something that we also have to consider, is there's this very beautiful world that even though there's suffering, we shouldn't destroy the rainforest, because we know that like there's a great good of just that the beauty of it existing. So that's just one point I would like to add for the purposes here.
Yeah, no, that's a good point, because we know that on theism, God aims at bringing about a plurality of good things. And some of these good things in which God brings about will come at a cost of certain bad things happening. And so if God wants to achieve a kind of maximal aesthetic beauty, well, there are certain genres of works of art, you could say, that involve tragedy, right? Mm-hmm. Now, some people will rightly, and this is, you know, getting the evidential argument right, will say things like, well, is the beauty, the aesthetic beauty of nature, enough to justify the horrendous suffering that have occurred to animals? And mm-hmm. I think as theists, we should say, well, no, it's not. We shouldn't. I think that it's quite obvious to see that the beauty of, like you're talking about the rainforest, is dwarfed in comparison to the intrinsic value of an animal experiencing intense pain that eventually leads to the end of their life, and ultimately causing them to really question whether or not they're, and us as well, whether or not their existence was worth having, right? in the first place. And so this is what Marilyn Adams points out, which is that if there's going to be an explanation for suffering, we have to take into account the creature's individual life. What do they think about their life? Because this is the idea that a creature's life could have been instrumental to the value of something else, such as the beauty of the rainforest or the aesthetic beauty we observe in nature. But it doesn't say anything about the value of that creature's life as a whole. Rather, it just shows that they're one part in a series of other value parts that might be good. But it's another question of whether the life was valuable on the whole. And so I think that those are another thing that we should take into account if we're going to give these aesthetic justifications. So that's the only thing I'm going to say about that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's great, Tim. I think for now, let's move on to the next little part here, which you can talk about now, human suffering. So you've addressed the problem of animal suffering.
Then there's human suffering. Take, for example, the psychological suffering a parent must go through who has to watch helpless as their young child dies slowly of starvation or an agonizing disease. The consensus among population experts is that over the sweep of human history, prehistory, hundreds of thousands of years, the parents of each generation have had to watch, on average, between a third and a half of their under five children die, usually from disease. Kenneth Hill, director of the Hopkins Population Center at Johns Hopkins University, writes, and I quote, "Over the long haul of prehistory, the probability of dying by the age of five for females was probably lower than 440 per thousand live births and was probably no higher than 600. That's to say, on average, around half of literally millions of generations of girls never made it beyond their fifth birthday. This appalling suffering and death was not something these children and parents brought on themselves. Unavoidable, unspeakable horror on an almost unimaginably vast scale is built into the very fabric of the world we find ourselves forced to inhabit."
Stephen Law is so articulate, yes. Great speaker. But what do you think here with his argument, Tim?
Yeah, so what he's really talking about is, and this is good, this is what atheist philosophers do, is that when they make these evidential arguments, they focus on the profusion of suffering, the most intense kinds of suffering, right? So he's bringing up an issue which could be categorized as a class of horrendous sufferings, right? And so there's not only the moral realm where humans are harming other humans or things, but then there's also the realm that we can't have control over, which is the natural, such as, you know, biological genetic defects and things of that sort that cause us to be impaired very greatly in our lives, causes us immense pain and suffering. And so I'm glad that Law brings up those for theism to be in tension with. My only question for him in this, because I think that we can cut straight through to what the real point of contention here is, can God have morally justifiable motivations for authorizing horrendous evils that befall humans? And this isn't the same thing that Craig usually says, which is, well, how do we not know, or can we really say that God doesn't have morally justifiable reasons? But what I mean is, can God have motivations for authorizing these evils to befall humans, of such of which meet a morally justifiable condition? And again, Law doesn't specify whether what these conditions even would be. Right. And so I think that, again, what I said earlier, if God doesn't either compensate the creatures or humans for their sufferings and also ensures their defeat, then I think that this is the problem. I think that that the suffering wins, basically. And I don't think that's character of an perfectly loving God who would stop at nothing to ensure the well-being of his creatures. So if he ultimately doesn't do that, then I think that we do have an argument, a successful one. But Law doesn't specify what these moral conditions would be, and so he doesn't. And that's the only way to really show that theism's made a false prediction here, in terms of horrendous suffering, is that, you know, we should start with some God justifying moral condition, and then we should look at the suffering, because that's going to be in our background knowledge. But he doesn't start with that, and so I think that that's missing. That's like the most crucial part that's missing from the argument. And so I think there's two moral conditions. God justifying norms, I guess you could say. I like to put it in terms of conditions, like John Schneider has in his book, again, on Darwinian problem of evil. And one is called the necessity condition and one is called the defeat condition. And so what's obviously often assumed axiologically here is that, well, God is going to do all that he can in his power to prevent suffering, as much suffering as he can, unless the suffering has to be allowed to prevent a greater evil or bring about a greater good. But not all suffering like that happens. And that's why they bring up horrendous suffering, because it's none of that type. But then there's the defeat condition, which says that God is justified in authorizing suffering if it can be defeated. And what it means to defeat a suffering is for a creature to integrate an evil into their lives as a necessary kind of great-making constituent that plays a role in rendering their lives valuable or good on the whole. And that when they look back on their suffering, they don't regret it. They actually are either thankful for it or they endorse it, and they're glad for their lives to be the way it is. And it doesn't render the evil that happened not evil. It still is evil, but their lives being as valuable as it is wouldn't be the way it is if the evil didn't occur, right? And so we have two conditions on the table. And I think that we need those conditions plus the factors I mentioned. Will God compensate and will he defeat, or will he not compensate and defeat? And I think that these things need to be on the table if we're going to make a successful argument from horrendous suffering, or else all we have is a description of the world and that's it. So what do you think?
Well, I think you're right. I think that in this next clip that we're going to play, Laws can get a little bit more into like his actual argument. But I mean, at this point now, he is still just kind of like giving data. He's talking about, in this case, like the suffering and deaths of like children, like how horrendous that is. And like, yeah, that's something really you have to deal with. And it's something that we need a good explanation for as Christians. So it's something that we need to think about as we move forward here, as we get into his actual argument. And one of those big questions that you talked about, Tim, is like, how much is atheism going to explain this data? Like, you could point at it and say like, hey, theism, there seems like there's no good explanation for why this is happening. But if atheism can't provide a good explanation either, then no one's really winning. There's no evidential like points, as you were bringing up here earlier, on either direction. So that's my thoughts here. I think that, you know, we could talk about the different like theodicies and things like that, but I don't think it's really relevant at this point of the context of what we're going through.
Yeah.
Okay, let's keep going then. Now Law's going to frame out his argument.
So now here's the argument. If Professor Craig's God exists, then these hundreds of thousands, nay, hundreds of millions of years of horror must ultimately be, well, all for the best. For an all-powerful, all-knowing, and all-good God, one, will know about, two, will have the power to prevent, and three, will desire that the world not contain any pointless, gratuitous suffering. If Professor Craig's God exists, there must be not just some reason, but an entirely adequate reason for every last ounce of all of this suffering and horror. But surely, as we look back across the eons, we witness suffering of such depth and magnitude that it becomes highly implausible that it can all be fully explained away. In which case, it looks like very powerful evidence against the existence of Professor Craig's God.
Tim.
I was just going quick. So basically what he's saying is what's unjustifiable. This is good. This is really good. He's giving us the condition. The kind of evil, the type of evil that's unjustifiable is the type that is gratuitous.
Mm-hmm.
Every evil, on Law's view, should somehow play a role in which God... in which God, if he were to prevent it, it would confer a great, great, great valuable loss, right? So it's what I said earlier. Evil is not gratuitous if it is if it allows for a greater good, or if it prevents a greater evil, right? But anything else besides that, the evil is considered pointless or gratuitous. This is the definition. This is the conditions that are argued for in the literature. And Law thinks that it is highly improbable that all of these horrendous evils that we observe somehow have some hidden explanation that there is some higher good that occurs from it, a good that counterbalances the evil that occurred. So you take some horrendous evil that happens, and there should be a good that just dwarfs that in value, that occurs directly from that. Or there should be some greater evil that is so much more immense than the evil that occurred. And the only way to make sure that that doesn't occur is to allow this evil over here to occur. And so he says it's just highly improbable that all these evils are like that. And honestly, I think that we as theists, we can grant him that there is a whole lot of gratuitous evil. But theists have argued that we don't really have to necessarily bite the bullet and say it's unjustifiable. I mean, William Hasker has argued that that gratuitous evil can play some role, right? He has a theodicy making that. And I ultimately think I'm in line with Trent Doherty, that I think that atheism's problem isn't with gratuitous evil. I think it's with indefeasible evil. So we're relying on a whole different condition here. And so I'm glad he laid out what's unjustifiable, but I don't think that the issue truly is with gratuitous evil. I think it's with evil that can never be redeemed.
Yeah.
So we can get more into that later as we go on, but yeah.
I like what you're saying, Tim, because it looks at the idea of like the idea that like if the suffering can be redeemed on like a theistic story, like take Law's example of like the 5-year-old who suffers and their parents suffer because they pass away. It seems like given theism, like their suffering can be redeemed for the 5-year-old and for the parents. So it seems like then if that's the case, then the argument's not going to be as big of a deal for the theist. Like it could be a good explanation, even if you don't have like a full one in this life, like you could allow for some like, well, yeah, in this life, like, yeah, that suffering just kind of caused some badness, but like it can be redeemed. So yeah, I think there's something really good there. And then something I'd like to bring in is just like the question of like the power of like indifference in explaining evil. Because Peter Van Engelen has a really good quote that I like with regards to the hypothesis of indifference. And he says, regarding this is not a very specific hypothesis. It tells us only that the nature and condition of sentient beings on Earth do not have a certain, very narrowly delineated cause. Perhaps it would not count as a proper competitor, referring to the principle of indifference, with the quite specific thesis that we have called theism. Perhaps it would only be a consequence of your solution that only some proposition more specific than the hypothesis of indifference would probably be in competition with theism, and this proposition might face difficulties of its own, difficulties not faced by the hypothesis of indifference. And what I think Peter Van Engelen is getting at is like you could say like point at like the theistic story and say, hey, this seems super weird in a contradiction with the perfect being. So indifference just like is a better explanation. But what Van Engelen Inwagen gets at is that indifference isn't really a good explanation because it doesn't really say anything. It doesn't say like, is there going to be like two particles? Is there going to be a million? Is there going to be a big bang? No big bang? Is there going to be something rather than nothing? It seems like indifference doesn't really explain any of that. So you have to build all that into your indifference if you want like full explanation of the world, and you can have a lot of trouble when you do that and just like destroy your priors and things like that. So that for me, what I want to get at is just wondering, like emphasizing again with what you have, Tim, number one, that like given theism, like evil can be defeated. Like that, there's no issue with saying that. It doesn't have to be in this life. And then number two, like indifference or atheism is going to have a lot of work to actually explain this evil. It can't just be like the alternative is just sitting, waiting, ready to go. So, yeah.
So real quick on the whole quote you gave by Inwagen, I think it's interesting how he frames it, because either indifference isn't specific enough to explain anything, so then it lacks explanatory power. So then if the atheist wants to explain something, then it might end up having even more difficulties, that of which are not faced by indifference. So it's like the hypothesis of indifference is made to be modest so that it doesn't have a low prior. But in doing so, it lacks explanatory power. But then a more specific proposition might be able to explain the evil. Something like Goff's agentive cosmopsychism theory, but then it's going to have a low prior, a lower prior than indifference as a cost. So I think that's really interesting how Inwagen frames that. I do want to straw man though indifference, because I think all what indifference is doing is indifference is saying that we should not expect, we have no reason to expect that there should be some valuable relationship between the states of affairs of the world and the features of fundamental reality. That we should not be able to draw a link between value and then the foundation, right? So the idea is that, well, what value is there in gratuitous suffering that can be drawn to the goodness of God, right? But on indifference, we don't need that assumption. We don't need that assumption that there's this kind of teleological trajectory towards value in every state of affairs that occurs. And so if reality is indifferent, then it's going to be unsurprising that there's so much disvalue in the states of affairs that have occurred. And I think that's what someone who is defending indifference would say. And so it's not necessarily that it makes a substantial prediction, but rather it makes a neutral one. So it's almost basically like the naturalist is having a safer bet. Like it's safer for me, given the data that I go with indifference than theism, because neutral beats negative. So that's the kind of idea there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's definitely super helpful, Tim. So anything else you want to say with regards to like this section of Bob's argument, or do you want to get into the evil God challenge?
No, let's get right into it.
All right, sounds good. So this is going to be a big clip that we're going to play. We're probably not going to pause it. It's about 10 minutes long, and Law's going to really hammer down on the evil God challenge.
Now, interestingly, a similar argument can be run against an alternative God hypothesis I want you now to consider. Suppose that, after a bump on the head, I become convinced that the universe is the creation of a single all-powerful designer. However, I also believe this being is evil. There's just one God, and he's cruel. He's as cruel and evil as it's possible for him to be. Who believes in a creator like that? Hardly anyone outside of a mental institution. Yet notice that this evil God hypothesis is as well supported by, say, Professor Craig's cosmological and fine-tuning arguments. Sorry, he didn't run fine-tuning argument today, it was just the three. His cosmological argument, as his belief is, Professor Craig's cosmological argument, as his belief in his good God hypothesis. That argument failed to provide us with any clue at all as to our creator's moral character. Yet still, I'm sure you consider the idea of such an evil creator absurd. Why? Well, one obvious reason for dismissing the idea is that our world is clearly not the sort of world an all-powerful and maximally evil being would create. Take a look at it. Yes, it contains suffering, but it also contains a great deal of good, far too much for it plausibly to be considered the creation of such an evil being. Why, for example, would an evil creator, intent on maximizing evil, give us beautiful scenery to enjoy? Why would he allow people to reduce the suffering of others, sometimes quite selflessly? An evil God would want to maximize suffering and prevent morally virtuous behavior, so surely he'd clamp down on, say, Mother Teresa's activities straight away, and he'd destroy all the hospitals. Why, you might also ask, would an evil God bestow on some people immense health, wealth, and happiness? David Beckham, for example, who seems to lead a charmed existence. And why would an evil God give us children to love? Evil God hates love. Surely the last thing he'd do is populate the world with endless bundles of joy. So you might think there is, on the face of it, overwhelming observational evidence against the evil God hypothesis. I'm sure some of you have spotted that what we're looking at here is, in effect, the evidential problem of good. If you believe in a good God, you face the problem of explaining why there's so much bad stuff in the world. If you believe in an evil God, you face the mirror problem of explaining why there's so much good. So why, we might ask, if the problem of good is fatal to the evil God hypothesis, and surely it is the problem of evil not similarly fatal to the good God hypothesis? If one hypothesis is pretty straightforwardly falsified by observation of the world around us, why isn't the other one? Now, as you know, Christians have cooked up some pretty ingenious explanations for all the bad stuff. Let's look at a few explanations, beginning with free will. Some Christians try to explain certain evils by saying that being good, God gave us free will, the ability to make free choices and act on them. Why? Because God wants to allow for the possibility of moral goodness. God could have made us puppet beings that were automata that always did the right thing, but puppet beings lack moral responsibility. Their good behavior, if compelled, would not be morally good. So God cut our strings. He set us free. As a result, some of us choose to do evil. That's the price God must pay to allow for moral goods. I'm sure you're familiar with that sort of explanation, but now notice that someone who believes in an evil God can mirror it with a free will explanation of their own. Evil God gave us free will. Why? To allow for the possibility of moral evil. Evil God could have made us puppet beings, automata that always did the bad thing, but puppet beings lack moral responsibility. Their bad behavior, if compelled, would not be morally evil, and so evil God cut their strings. As a result, some of us choose to do good. That's the price evil God must pay to allow for moral evils. You can see I've taken a standard Christian theodicy and just flipped it around. Here's another example of theodicy flipping. Some Christians try to explain pain and suffering as the result of the operation of laws of nature, laws that are nevertheless on balance supposed to be good. So, for example, a Christian might argue that without a law-governed universe in which the effects of our actions can be predicted, we can't morally interact with each other. Suppose I see you cold and hungry. In order to help you by lighting you a warming fire and cooking you a much-needed meal, I need to know both that by striking a match I'll create a flame and that wood burns to release heat. Unfortunately, these same laws of nature have a downside. They entail that there will occasionally be, say, spontaneous forest fires that cause suffering. That's the price God pays for greater goods. Again, someone who believes in an evil God can produce a mirror explanation to account for goods. In order to allow the very great evil of my burning down your wooden house with you and your family inside, they may say, I need to know both that by striking a match I will create a flame and that wood burns. Such laws of nature are required for such very great evils to exist. True, these same laws have good consequences. They allow people to cook each other warming meals, for example. That's the price evil God pays for greater goods. We can similarly flip around familiar Christian suggestion that the pain and suffering we endure is there to allow us to grow and develop morally and spiritually. Yes, evil God wants us to suffer, do evil, and despair. To that end, he introduces various goods into the world. But then why, you may ask, would an evil God allow a few people, such as David Beckham, to lead a charmed life? Why? To make the rest of us feel worse, of course. To invoke feelings of jealousy and resentment in others, to motivate crime, riots perhaps. Why would an evil God pepper his creation with some beauty which we enjoy? Because he requires a contrast. In order to fully appreciate the drab dreariness of day-to-day life, we need to be reminded now and then of how much better things might have been. Why would an evil God give us children to love? Because it's only if we truly unconditionally love someone that we can be made to suffer as we do when evil God kills them slowly before our eyes. In short, someone might conclude this is not, as many Christians suppose, a veil of soul-making. It is a veil of soul destruction, engineered by an evil God intent on crushing and breaking our spirits so that we bow out in agony and despair, as so very many of us do. While not all standard Christian explanations for evil can be reversed in this way, most can. Take, for example, explaining evil in terms of God's mysterious ways. A defender of belief in an evil God can adopt the same ruse, putting the God we see around us down to evil God's mysterious ways. After all, evil God is omnipotent and omniscient, isn't he? So, of course, his evil plans are likely to be largely beyond our understanding. Just because certain goods appear to us to be quite gratuitous, given his evil aims, gives us no reason to suppose that they really are gratuitous. Don't presume to know the mind of evil God. Moreover, just as some Christians maintain that whatever horror we experience in this life will be more than compensated for in the next, those who believe in an evil God can maintain that whatever goods we experience in this life will be more than compensated for by the far deeper, unremitting horror of the next. Clearly, despite these and various other ingenious maneuvers that might be made in defense of belief in an evil God, it remains the case that there's far, far too much good stuff in the world for it to be the creation of such an evil deity. We can still, on the basis of what we observe around us, reasonably conclude that there's unlikely to be an evil God. So my question is, if the evil God hypothesis can, solely on the basis of observational evidence, be ruled out as highly unlikely, why can't we similarly rule out the good God hypothesis? True, we may not know the answer to the question, why does the universe exist? Perhaps we'll never know. It doesn't follow that we can't quite reasonably rule certain answers out. Obviously, we can quite reasonably rule out the evil God hypothesis and on the basis of what we can see around us. So why not the good God hypothesis? Why suppose, as I assume Professor Craig does, that the good God hypothesis is not just a bit more reasonable, but very significantly more reasonable than the evil God hypothesis? For remember, the latter hypothesis remains downright absurd, notwithstanding such appeals to evil God's mysterious ways and so. That's the challenge I'm putting before Professor Craig tonight, to explain why belief in a good God is, on the basis of the available evidence and arguments, not just a bit more reasonable than belief in an evil God, but very significantly more reasonable than belief in an evil God. How might Professor Craig respond to this challenge? Well, he's given his arguments for his particular God, of course. I'll examine those next. Though notice that the first one was completely neutral on God's moral properties, so it provides no support for a good God over an evil God. In fact, Dr. Craig is now down to two arguments. He may also try to disarm the problem of evil, perhaps by invoking a smokescreen of skepticism and mystery. He may say, well, we...
Okay, I think I went a little bit further than I was hoping to with regards to the last clip, but he laid out a lot with the evil god challenge and like the problems, like its symmetry, the problem of evil. So Tim, where do you want to take this?
Yeah, so the evil god challenge, this is going to be, I think, the most exciting part. I really like the way he laid it out, trying to do his whole theodicy flipping, or his, you know, parroting of theodical justifications. Mm-hmm. So the first part I want to ask is just like some more like foundational things about the evil god hypothesis, which is, you know, can an infinitely evil god, you know, because he did keep the omni properties, be said to be coherent? I mean that's a completely, you know, understandable question. You know, if a theist is going to put forth, like someone like Richard Swinburne is going to posit the existence of God as the best explanation of certain data, then it should obviously be coherent. So if this is going to be something to be taken seriously on the table, well, the explanation should at least be coherent. And it's not to say that Law is actually putting forth this as a rival explanation, but he's using this to show that you could equally give a justification for the way the world is if an evil god were to exist as well. But I think that's also important. Could an evil god even exist, you know, mm-hmm. In the infinitary sense? So I'm going to say, by my lights, no. And the reason why is I hold to a moderate view of divine simplicity, the kind defended by Joshua Sijuwadi in his paper, An Aspectival Account of Divine Simplicity, which I think is the best and most coherent defense of divine simplicity. And basically, I view when we talk about God, I view him in terms of a trope of a modular kind, a module trope, and one that is a powerful module trope. So I'm keeping powers here. I believe in the existence of powers. And I think that the moment you have omnipotence, you just get goodness. And Swinburne thinks that this is held through an entailment relation. I actually think this is held, just like Sijuwadi does, through through a numerical identity relation. You can find it in the paper, but he does a great job of explaining how aspect theory helps better understand how these certain things, as we would call kind of separable properties or attributes, are actually numerically identical to omnipotence. Almost in a sense, they're like these like qua relations, you could say, where an aspect of omnipotence is the power to know, the power to be able to perform a best action where there is one, or the next best action where there is one, or a best kind of action, or a incommensurably good action and no bad action, right? You have the power to, you're omnipotent insofar as you have the power to do and know all the truths about value, all the truths about good, and how to perform those things. And I think that when we look at it in terms of power, then what we can say is powers are like another way of kind of seeing things as perfections, which is that if you have a power without limit or any regulations or parameters or constraints, then I think what happens is the power to do evil isn't a power, because if you look at the reasons why humans do evil, you know, there's still kind of a primitive sense in which we do evil, right? We do evil because of self-preservation. And so we're limited, right? We have to preserve we're fragile, right? If we were infragile, we wouldn't have to be constantly seeking after self-preservation. We do evil, to gain power, right? We feel as though, there is something over and against us that we need to overcome or something. And we do evil sometimes to get revenge, right? Which means that we don't have, we lack the capacity or the strength, at least, to be able to forgive in those circumstances, right? So as I go through these examples, what you see is evil is actually a consequence of being limited in power. So I think a being that is just has power with zero limit, there's just no interest in doing any kinds of evil. And so I think that if there's an omni being that's evil, that's an incoherent concept. Finite, though, that would make sense. By the same time, that would get us into other questions about, can a finite evil God be responsible for the distribution of good and evil we observe in the universe? And can it even be said to be the right kind of source for those things? So anyways, I'll hand it over to you on that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I guess I'll take it a little bit different angle, because I'm not super like well thought out with regards to like my thoughts on like divine simplicity and things like this. But, like, for me, like, if I think of God as like a perfect being, it seems really weird to say like God is like perfectly good, perfectly powerful, all powerful, all knowing, perfectly evil. Like, that seems kind of weird to think of, like, what would it mean to be like, can you be perfect and then be evil at the same time? Right. It just seems like that's kind of like there's a straight like contradiction there. We're saying a being's perfect, which, you know, like theists want to say, and then also that a being's evil. So there seems like there's a contradiction there. So for like the theist, it doesn't seem like it's going to be a super persuasive form of argument, because they already have in their data, like, typically, like, God is a perfect being. So I think if you start with perfection, then it's going to be a really big challenge for the evil God to get going, because it seems like an evil is just like contrary to perfection. It seems like a very plausible intuition about the world. So that's my big hang up with the basics of what Law is saying. I do think like his take on like theodicies and things is very interesting, because I think that some of his intuitions I got is like, yeah, you could defend that, looking at the data of the world. Obviously, there's some weird things, but, you know, you could say the same thing about the good God side. So that's where I'm at right now with regards to thinking about everything going on right now.
Yeah, I think that's from kind of taking kind of a perfect foundation theory, kind of like Rasmussen does. It's like, if you're going to look at what a perfection is, you know, absolute perfection, and tease out what these perfections may be, you're going to be hard pressed to find a theist who considers evil a perfection.
Mm-hmm.
Because a perfection is an idealized excellence. It's a praiseworthy trait of character, or a praiseworthy quality. And we don't look at evils or bads in terms of something that's praiseworthy or quality. So there's multiple ways you can do it. You can either look at it through omnipotence and the relations or properties that it has, or perfection and then the relations it has. And I think in either sense, you don't, it doesn't look good on that side. So, yeah.
Yeah, I think that's great. Anything else you want to say, Tim, with this before we get into the last clip, where you can talk about like the evil God challenge and natural theology symmetries?
So I think that when it comes to him parroting the theodicies, I think that it has many explanatory deficits, and I don't think that it can do what he's trying to say that it can. So I don't think it can predict why the distribution of evil we observe is the way that it is, instead of some other way that better reflects malevolence, right? And so, for example, Trent Doherty gives an argument in his book on animal suffering called a fine-tuning argument from evil, where if God is motivated to bring about the highest goods and the highest excellences in creatures, what he calls saintliness, then there needs to be a certain way the world is structured such that it brings about a certain intensity and frequency of what you could call challenges that creatures would have to face, that provides a sufficient opportunity to become saintly and a sufficient chances of success in actually achieving it, such that if it's too intense and too frequent, it's not going to happen. And if it's too infrequent and not intense enough, you're still not going to be able to achieve it. So you have to have the kind of right intensity and right frequency for the sufficient number of people sufficient opportunity and sufficient chances of success for it to be attained. And what Trent points out is, well, that seems to reflect our world is a token of that type. And we have a type of world that is structured towards stateliness, and our world seems to be a token of that type, where our world has produced a plurality of saints. And what I mean by saints is not saints in exclusively the Christian sense, but saintly character, right? And we can find this in other belief systems, religions, and regions of the world where this is being exemplified, that the world seems structured to bring us the kinds of challenges to where it produces saintly character. And I think that is much, much more epistemically friendly on benevolence than it is on malevolence, because a malevolent being, if he wants to structure the world in such a way to produce, you know, the opposite, where you take everything I said but you make it for evil, well, this world is quite surprising given that. Saintly character so that they can experience more evil or something, that's weird. I would say that it can't predict the distribution we observe. And then it also just can't parrot theodical explanations, right? And so the way I define a theodicy is a theodicy just seeks to provide a narrative account of how God will redeem the suffering in the individual lives of creatures. So the way in which I define theodicy is inconsistent with the way in which you could parrot a theodicy. And what's really interesting is he talks about, you know, evils, you know, good, you know, you have certain goods so you can have certain evils, right? And the reason why God would authorize certain evils is because they are logical preconditions for the highest goods. But what's interesting about that is there are no goods in which are logical preconditions for the highest evils, right? I mean, think about it, right? It's well documented in multiple disciplines that a heart of gratitude and a consistent practice of gratitude is like the highest kind of positive state a human can be in. Gratitude is simply being aware of the good things in your life, right? And so I take something like the highest one, that I would say that's one of the highest, that's a virtue, right? A living a life and heart of gratitude. And I think that if someone, and it's been shown to cure depression, you know, it's been shown to better people's lives, right? It'd be weird to me that a great good such as a heart of gratitude would be a logical precondition for some kind of intense evil. I mean, right? Do you see that too? It's like if gratitude betters a person's life in a positive way, then how can that be a logical precondition for making a person's life worse? So it can't be a logical precondition for evil. So law can't make this argument. He can't, but we can. We can say that certain evils are logical preconditions for certain goods, such that are maybe even horrendous, right? I mean, certain challenges, such as, I mean, I've heard many people talk about how they have become, have grown immensely at the cost of a family member dying, right? It was able to teach them certain things about themselves. It was able to foster a kind of strength that they never had before, and an appreciation and learning to be more present in life and think about their own mortality. I just don't see that in the inverse there. So I think that that's a big devastating part to law trying to do this kind of theodicy flipping. And it's interesting because he mentions that afterlife would exist on an evil God hypothesis so that they could compensate the good with evil. And what's interesting is that the only reason why an afterlife exists on theism, you know, being benevolence, is that so God can justly compensate and defeat evils. So it becomes quite peculiar as to why an afterlife would exist in the same way as it would on theism for the evil God hypothesis. I mean, think about it. What God would be doing in the afterlife would be making sure that a creature's life can be good on the whole, what the bad that occurred to them as a necessary constituent of their life. And so without it, that creature's life could not be as good as it is. And so it plays a kind of great making role in that creature's life. But this, again, cannot be said for evil, since the good cannot be a great making feature for an overall bad life. A creature cannot integrate the good as a necessary constituent for a bad life on the whole, right? I mean, think about, let's say someone at the end of 2020, you meet up with a friend that you haven't seen in a long time, and you say, hey, how you been doing? How's your life? And they say, oh man, 2022 was the best year of my life. It would be quite odd for them to say subsequent to that, and I see my life as meaningless. Mm-hmm. Right? I mean, it was super strange. Like, I had the best year of my life. No one says after having the best year of their life that they consider their life on the whole worse.
Yeah.
So it just doesn't work. He can't do it. He can't parrot this. And I think that's a big problem.
Mm. I think there's also, like, one of the things I thought about is just, like, the idea that, like, the world just seems, like, aesthetically good, not aesthetically evil, or, like, intrinsically good, not intrinsically evil, which to me, like, just seems, like, to lend weight towards a good God. Because, like, if you're an evil God, like, assuming that's coherent, it seems like you're going to create an intrinsically evil world, not an intrinsically good world. So that's just one point, not necessarily related to what you're saying, Tim, but just something else that for me, like, seems to, like, put pretty damaging to, like, the idea of there being, like, an evil God.
Yeah, I see what you're saying, exactly.
So let's play this last little clip here where he's going to talk about evil God challenge and its symmetry to natural theology.
Well, we just can't presume to know, regarding all the horror we see around us, that God lacks adequate reasons for it. But as we've just seen, we can use the same sort of smokescreen to defend belief in an evil God. We can say, well, we just can't presume to know, regarding all the goods we see around us, that evil God lacks adequate reasons for them. So Professor Craig cannot, by means of such a smokescreen, show that belief in his good God is better supported than belief in an evil God. It will be interesting to see, I'll be interested to see, how he thinks it can be shown to be better supported. Now, that went really fast. I'm left with 2 minutes, and I just want...
Okay, now he just kind of wraps up. My apologies, I got the clips wrong. I thought that he was going to talk about natural theology here. But, like, Tim, what do you think about the idea that, like, an evil God could say, like, it's very symmetrical, like, your cosmological, your fine-tuning, or whatever arguments you want to run can also just be used for an evil God, and they don't really lend any weight to a good God.
Yeah, well, what's really interesting to me is I like this style of reasoning. One reason why is I think that this is a stronger way to argue against theism. I don't think that you can... This can't be an argument for atheism. Mm-hmm. Which is interesting, but I also think that it also helps us kind of think through these things. But I also think that even somebody like Philip Goff's agentive cosmopsychism could equally work. And so I don't think it exclusively favors an evil God, right? Because on Philip Goff's view is you have a universe which is on the whole conscious. And the universe, it's an axiarchic view. So the universe is conscious, but the universe is also driven towards producing and creating good things. But the universe is inherently limited. So it's finite in its own, in its power. And so it can produce a plurality and a mixed bag of good things, but it cannot prevent any evil from occurring, or most evils from occurring, sorry, because it's finite in power. So it's axiarchic because it has a natural disposition towards good, but it's finite in that it doesn't have the power to prevent a lot of evil that occurs.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that can equally explain what the evil God can explain as well. Without you positing a kind of God thing. Rather, this seems to be more natural in certain senses. I think that someone like Graham Oppy would deny that this is considered natural. So I think there's other hypotheses on the table that maybe the evil God hypothesis is in tension with Philip Goff's view, right? And again, these can't be arguments for atheism. because Philip Goff's view is axiarchic in nature. And I would say that's a different class of grand theories. And then you have the evil God, right? And so I think that what Law is trying to do is he's trying to do something to exclude or greatly disconfirm theism from being true, from being the case by parodying it in this way. But it can't be used as positive justification for atheism in that sense. So I don't want people to kind of, you know, take me to task on not understanding what Law is trying to do here with that. But it definitely disconfirms theism. And so if you have these comparisons on the table, how, you know, Bayesian confirmation theory works, it would, either way, it would disconfirm theism, and all other theories on the table would kind of go up the ladder, I guess you could say, or move up the starting line or something like that, whatever analogy or illustration you want to work with. So it'd be a confirmation in some sense. Depends on how many theories you're comparing.
Yeah, I think that's great. Well, I don't really have anything else to add here, Tim. So do you have any last thoughts or things you want to say before we wrap up and close up shop for the day?
Let me think. I mean, the only thing I'll conclude with really is that I think that, again, like you were saying, I think Stephen Law does a really good job of articulating himself. I think he's a good speaker. And I think that he's presented something novel that all theists should at least at some point kind of consider if they're looking into the kind of evidential arguments from evil or the whole gambit of the problem of evil. And I think that in the end, it can serve both sides. If anybody wants to know more about kind of the things that I have been responding with and my kind of responses, anything with Kyle Allender on this channel and myself are good resources. And then I have two resources with me here. Well, one is Trent Doherty's book on animal pain. It's very expensive on Amazon. I got this during the Palgrave sale for $11.99. You can get it cheap when that happens and things, but this is a very, very, very nuanced book. I think the best book on answering evil from a theistic perspective that's out there. And you can see some of the themes in which I was mentioning in that, and as well as the late Marilyn Adams, Horrendous Evils and the Goodness of God, where she goes over the same kinds of things as well, but very masterful theodicist and analytic philosopher as well. So I think those are some good resources that people, if they want to look more into how theists truly respond, the best kind of responses to evil, they can look at those things.
Well, I think that's great, Tim. I've really enjoyed this conversation. I almost need to make a playlist with like all the stuff that like you and Kyle have done on this channel, because it's been a lot now. And yeah, I think it's great. Obviously, a lot of respect to Dr. Law, very articulate. And I think that's it for today. The full debate is linked down below, and Tim's channel is just added in the description, so you can go check out the debate and check out Tim's content invoking theism. I feel like I need to make some witty comment about how you never upload videos, because it's pretty much everyone else does. So, but Tim has a lot of great stuff on his channel.
Forever AFK.
But thank you everyone for tuning in. I hope you have a good one, and God bless. We'll see you next time. If you got your own content, always encourage you to become a patron. Your support means a lot. But that's it. So see you, and God bless.